Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Zyori Podcast. I want to thank you for joining us here for podcast number 92. It's March 16th, 2016, about 12:30, half past noon here on the eastern coast of good old beautiful New Jersey. Today, we've got a special episode here of the Zyori Podcast. We have a dear friend, a dear comrade, and also a terrible enemy. Icelement, aka Icelement, Rob, whatever his last name is. You might know him from Twitter. You might know him from something called the Summits 1, 2, 3, and 4. Maybe DAC, some other events that you've done there, Rob. Huh? You've done some stuff, right, buddy?
I've been around the block like once.
Once or twice. Yep. Longtime Dota fan and somewhat recent full-time esportser, building studios, constructing studios, pushing buttons, pulling levers, supporting talent, and most importantly, ordering tables. He is the man behind the camera, or one of several, I guess, at BTS. I didn't realize how many like full-time people you guys have now. If you look at the staff page on your website, it's you guys got a big ship, huh?
Well, we've added a few people over the past few months. I'd say that the selection process is a little harder since we're still small. Mm-hmm. But the team's growing. It's becoming a family. I like it. Everybody I work with is fun and somewhat knowledgeable about what they do at the very least. You know, everybody's pulling their weight. So it's going well.
I remember the initial efforts of trying to hire people and interviewing local candidates in SoCal. I don't know why I volunteered for that job. It sounded like fun on paper, and then in practice it was much harder than I thought it would be.
Yeah, screening these people, well, I mean, look at what you had to go through just talking to me.
Yeah,
I mean, I remember that day you took us out to some sushi.
Hell yeah.
No idea if the restaurant was good. It was kind of whatever. But hey, you know what? No need to impress me. I was happy to be there.
I mean, the first time we met... Was that, I can't even remember the context. Was that for a, was that like a real interview or was that just more of kind of like a, hello friend. I didn't even know you at the time. I was just friends with Joy.
Well, yeah, it started that way. Like, and that's a good thing that people ask me a lot of the time. Like, how did you even get into esports? My girlfriend at the time messaged you on Twitter. I guess you had said like, oh, we need help at the summit. Just randomly, she messaged you and then mentioned like, hey, let's do this. I thought, okay, it can't be that bad. These guys seem like they're not terrible. And we drove down there and met you and, you know, I guess you thought we weren't completely out
no,
of
that's,
line.
No, that's pretty close. She tweeted at me, as did many people, to help out with summits. And I kind of went, yeah, whatever. And then she either tweeted at me again or I think she added me on Steam or something and then mentioned that you guys were going to be in the area. And then that was how the whole thing started. The only reason I talked to her to begin with is because she was a girl. I'm not going to lie. Like, that was the only reason we started chatting a little bit. And she didn't lie, but she was not forthcoming that she was basically married.
That's
not
her,
disclosed.
Yeah, I actually, it's funny. I never heard it that way. But that's, I'm not surprised that you were continuing to talk with her because of that. It's funny that it even came up that way. I'm surprised that she had to message you more than once. Honestly, usually she just pops into these things and like, hey, let's do something completely out of the blue.
Yeah, I don't remember how she stood out of the crowd to me because everyone wants to work at the summit, you know, especially like the first few. We got a huge influx of messages and emails of people. And the problem was, how do you screen them when it's all like unsolicited stuff like that? It's like, well, this guy could be really normal and passionate and cool, or he could be a fucking axe murderer. And I honestly have no idea. Like,
and that's the toss up when you're looking at people. And like, for instance, for me, you guys got the latter, which is unfortunate. But when you were looking at people, because, you know, in the three summits worth of time that you were here, you did get a few people in here other than myself, I believe. So, I mean, what was like the big criteria that actually made people stand out to you?
Well, it depends for sort of what we're talking about. For working like the company run events like the summit and stuff, the hardest part was it's sort of quote unquote skillless jobs that you need people for. Like being a driver isn't hard, but you still want somebody who's like responsible and really understands the social limits of interacting with players. I mean, you know all this all too well. And I at the time, I remember not having a good mechanism to like be able to tell that in people. Like, what questions do I ask to be able to tell if this guy's just all around not a fucktard? You know, we weren't looking for people with specific skills, just people that were normal and responsible and into Dota, which is hard to screen for. For the other jobs, like, you know, we're talking about trying to find a producer and, you know, like a business person, like kind of Gerg's job now and that kind of stuff. It was always hard to narrow down the priority and what specific job we wanted. Like, there was a while where we wanted the, like, the tech director guy that was like an expert in gear and also live switching and lighting and also like offline editing and just all around fucking media guru. And it's like, well, that guy's not cheap at all. I don't know if that's really where we're at right now.
Doesn't exist for very cheap. No.
Yeah. That's a lot of skills to have in one package.
We need someone with 15 years of experience and a guy with 1 year of experience price. Let's do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That's hard to find. And that's something that, you know, as we expand, we're still looking at new people. We're looking for specific jobs. And there have been a few jobs posted on the website. But it is hard to fill that role. And one of the biggest parts, like you said, is that sanity factor. Because I think that's the hardest thing to screen for, is that there's plenty of people qualified for a job. But like, which one is the least absolute batshit crazy? And that's
yeah,
that just takes time and effort to sift through.
Yeah. Well, that was kind of what it was like with you guys. It was just sort of, all right, you guys seem like pretty normal Dota people. And then the first summit, I sort of felt like we got a little lucky and it was like rolled the dice. You guys fucking drove down from San Francisco, got there at what, like midnight the night before?
No, that was actually like 3 a.m.
3 a.m.?
I remember we had to wake up your roommate at the time in the hotel room.
I remember that. Oh, God.
And actually, because you said, like, just come in. It doesn't matter what time. Like, all right, we're knocking on the door, like, 3:30 in the morning.
Yeah, I was passed out hard.
Just holding, like, four suitcases. Like, all right, I hope this is a real thing. I mean, coming into that, my perspective was, all right, we met this guy once, and they're doing some crazy-ass tournament that seems unrealistic.
I mean, at the time,
just,
it
like,
did.
At the time, it was. And we're knocking on a hotel room door at 3 in the morning so that we can get up at 7 in the morning and do God knows what. At the time, I was told I'm a bodyguard, like I, or something like
that. You were
that.
The gatekeeper at Summit 1. Oh my God. I remember we had this whole vision of we wanted to like have a current list of people in, people out, and at all times know like where anyone was. So if a team's missing, it's like, okay, where were they last? You know, who is in the house right now? Who's not in the house? And that ended up being kind of a futile effort, like counting individually and then. It doesn't really open up much more efficiency knowing where everybody is if you don't have a good mechanism to communicate the transports.
Wouldn't you know it? Communication is a big thing.
Yeah.
And we've gotten the logistics down at this point. You know, we've run our fourth summit. It's it was actually interesting. It was like a noticeable difference not having you there for a full-on summit.
At Summit 4, you mean?
A lot of those roles were like finally absorbed into other people having to do them.
Yeah.
But I think we may do all right.
Well, you know? It's kind of weird because the position that I was in, it was sort of like myself, LD, Gods, and Brian were kind of like the top four, so to speak. And we made a lot of the decisions, especially for the summit. We all ran different sectors of it. So it wasn't like you could just say, all right, well, Zyori's gone. Let's replace him with somebody else because it was such an odd medley of stuff that I did, like logistics as well as casting and a little bit of talent stuff. And then, you know, you and I kind of tag teamed a lot of the transportation, other logistics stuff. So it was kind of it makes sense that you would split it up and divvy it across other people, but it also makes sense
like
that it would feel weird afterwards.
It's like this nice communal dinner. Everybody's bringing some ingredients and you get to someone's house and you make them all together, but like you get this guy that's like, oh, Ron's coming every week and he's not coming anymore. We need someone to bring like the celery and the potatoes and the mustard or what. I have no idea. I'm not a cook. Anyways, and then you get this guy coming in here and he's bringing kale. And he's bringing like orange juice, and you're like, guys, this isn't gonna work for the recipe.
What up?
It's just not gonna work. terrible, me and my metaphors, but it kind of is beautiful when it all comes together and you make something good of it.
Yeah.
And I think that the Summit 4 was great in that aspect that we had slacks here and we were able to like really show off because so much fun stuff happens, you know, from personal experience. There's actually so much fun happening like, at all times during those events. And there's so much shit going on and it's really enjoyable. The Dota's great, but you only get to see so much of that. You usually are either watching the match from a viewer perspective or you're seeing the couch shot.
Yeah.
But like every other angle of that first person is just great. So having us show a little more of that with slacks there was huge. Well,
it's surprisingly hard to capture too, you know, because you know there's a lot of cool stuff going on and you think when you witness it, man, if I was holding a camera right now and recorded this, this would have been really cool. But then you sort of realize, well, if I was holding a camera, then people wouldn't be acting the way that they are and I wouldn't, it wouldn't have happened to begin with. So there's this weird kind of chicken and egg thing with you don't want to be too invasive and jam cameras in people's faces, but you definitely want, the whole point of the event is to capture personality, show the human side of the players, you know? And Slacks is really fucking good at that. He is so good at making fun of people and then making them feel good about it. Like when we did the Netflix or the Moonduck and Chill thing for the Shanghai qualifier, part of what we did was bring subs on and let them chat with us on TeamSpeak for whatever until we got tired of them. And he was so good at just like laying into them and saying pretty mean stuff and then like finding some way to make like a personalized kind of, you know, sort of compliment to counteract it. And then they would just sort of laugh along. And usually people would leave feeling like, wow, that was pretty fun. I was part of the show. And the rest of us are just kind of sitting there awkwardly like, damn, I wouldn't have said that to that poor guy. I just would have asked him about his feelings and been boring.
Well, that's the difference between you and Jake, huh? Yeah. I mean, that guy, he's got a beautiful mind. He is something. I in all my 26 years of living, I have not met a person quite like him. In many aspects, so
me neither. I'm a big fan, though. I don't know what I often relish in the fact that Slacks is a part of my life and get sad at the thought. You know, like when you get a dog and you don't like it at first, and then one day, well, you might not know because I don't know if you ever really bonded with it, but that day comes where you're just like, this dog is fucking awesome. I love this thing. And then you just like think about the day that that dog is going to die and how you're mentally going to be able to deal with it. That's like my love for Slacks. The day that he says, you know what, BTS offered me $100,000 a year to go make fucking shit videos on their YouTube, that's the day that my heart breaks. What am I going to do without having Slacks as a trusted confidant, man? He has such a good, well-rounded, like, no bullshit perspective on life. It's unreal. He is one person that I can always trust to hit me, like, with it the way it is. I'm like, dude, just tell me honestly, is this shit? Am I being an asshole? What am I doing wrong here? And he'll just fucking say it. He doesn't care. You know, he doesn't give a shit about my feelings. I need more friends like that.
I think you do. I think you get away with way too much.
You think
just
I do?
Way too much bullshit. Actually, recently I was thinking that as well. I'm like, God, you know what? I wish that like the past few years people would just call me on my bullshit more. It really helps a lot to have someone that's just a straight shooter around you that's kind of calling out the nonsense, because it'll really get you set in line and remember like what you're doing. You're not getting off track, keeping focus. So
yeah, no, you're definitely right. That was one of the good vibes that we had at BTS for like that first year that I was there. There was a lot of really constructive criticism back and forth. Like after cast, people would always like give each other a lot of just feedback and not be afraid to say like, you talked over me here, you know, you fucked up this there and stuff. Like it was, that was one of the biggest changes for me, like growing as a caster, going from the environment where you're casting at your house and you're like, well, that was okay, there are obviously some areas I fucked up, some that I didn't. Overall, B+. I don't know, how was that cast? And then you go into an environment like that where you're around all of these experts all the time that just live to absorb Dota. And that kind of feedback is what pushes you to the next level, not just grinding mindlessly over and over. You know, it's like the difference between grinding solo queue versus grinding games with Purge yelling in your ear telling you what to do. That you're going to learn a lot more in the second one.
I was about to say the same thing. It feels like more like competitive play. You know, you've got that high level that people are giving you advice that's like more advanced than that basic feedback you'd get in a lot of other environments like a pub or something. So yeah, man, when you get the chance to work with good people that know what they're doing, you take that opportunity to learn. And yep. And I think that everybody in this industry does that, because if you don't, you're just not going to stay around.
Yeah, dude, that's like not even an option. It's a fucking requirement that you have to. Every time I come across someone now that like I make a video with, or I see them make a video and then they don't want to watch it when it's live, I just sort of think to myself, like, I understand, because everyone in the creative industry has been there at some point in their life when they're like, oh, I don't want to watch myself. But literally every single successful person in the entertainment industry has gotten over that and learned how to fucking watch themselves, because that's the only way you improve. That's the only way you can identify your weak points and stuff that you do wrong. And if you don't do that, you just get left behind, because the people that do it are improving at a much faster rate. It's hard,
yeah,
man.
It's really a necessity, though. I mean, if you're not going
to
learn.
So you're going to go back and listen to this podcast and take notes? Is that the...
Oh, yeah.
While you're doing it, could you do the timestamps for me? Because that shit's a pain in the ass.
Jeez.
All right. Too soon. Okay. So, Rob, tell me about China, man. You went to China. This was your first big travel event. You know, you've done a lot of local events in Cali, but not only your first time doing a big event like this as production, but also traveling abroad to China. So all sorts of funsies, yeah. I'm sure you encountered, eh?
First time out of the country.
Okay.
I live in California my whole life, you know, and so it was what I expected to be some culture shock, having never been out of the U.S., but it actually felt kind of right. I don't know what it is about.
What?
I can't quite define it. I really enjoyed Shanghai. I don't know what it is. Maybe it was just that I kind of more into it.
You like Asians. Like, you're physically attracted to Asians, right? If you're looking for a girlfriend, you go for the Asians. That's your thing?
Yes. Well,
there you go. I mean,
historically, maybe. I don't know.
Okay.
Listen, Andrew. We both know. Let's not even go down that path. Anyway, Shanghai. So, I really like the city. The fact that you're in, like, the most, like, basically the biggest, most sprawling city in the world. It just never ends. Like, you're just looking at buildings on the skyline forever, and it really feels awesome. You feel pretty small in the city, but not in a bad way. And the food was absolutely great. I mean, I stopped eating at the hotels and the buffets, like, very quickly, within a few days, because some of the food is just unmatched. I went on a huge spicy run with Ben. We went out and just got, like, spicy ramen and hot pot and stuff every day. It was great.
Okay. So the cuisine was top-notch. Did you have, the good hot pot?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You got it Szechuan style.
Yeah, yeah.
Burned your mouth off.
The legit hot pot over there is fucking, it's banging, man. You're just throwing food in there, eating mushrooms, eating beef. Oh.
I mean, we got stuff that Ben was saying was, like, a 9 out of 10 hot. Like,
9 out of 10 on the Merlini,
like,
scale?
You know Ben's dead. And I was
Holy
eating with
fuck.
Him. I'm sitting there. I mean, I got a picture. I'll probably tweet it at some point. Maybe when it's relevant. I
Dude.
Don't know. I couldn't. Oh, that was one thing in China, though. I was disconnected. I didn't have a VPN. So, and I thought, you know, I'm not that important. I don't need to be talking to people. I can be disconnected. So
What? You didn't take a VPN? Are you crazy?
No, I was offered a VPN a few times while people were. You know,
dude,
people hear
you didn't
about
want to use Twitter? That. Come on, man. You got to up your social media game. You're a personality now, dog. What the fuck you doing?
See, if I had had this podcast before China, maybe things would be a
You need to
story.
Hire me as your personal PR manager, man. Jesus Christ. You
got
to get your face
like
out there. I'll be in there fighting
shit.
For you. Like, no, LD, Rob's on the couch today. We're getting a production cam, and we're showing Rob. He's real. Everybody needs to know.
Oh, the loss of viewership, I can only imagine. So anyways, the city's great. The food's great. You know, it's a very different world. No one speaks the language. Or no one speaks English, really.
The language, it's, yes. American bias, not so much, eh?
It's a lot less common.
Yeah.
But you can still get by. And I knew my basic phrases. And I was actually really having fun with it. Learning. I know you learned a little bit while you were over there.
Basically just shay shay, that's it. Ni hao shay shay.
I've forgotten how much of a disappointment you are. yeah, you know, I picked up a few things, like your basics, your numbers, and your yes and no, and like how much does this cost, and things like that. And I could kind of get by talking to
Did you haggle?
There.
Did they give you tickets to sell?
No, I did. You know, I didn't haggle. They didn't give me tickets. This was a very different setup than DAC.
Damn it.
But they're a lot less loosey-goosey. However, I did experience the ever-present white man tax you get when you're... So let's say I go into a shop, and this happened twice. I'd buy a few items, maybe a little soda pop. Maybe some pocky, you know, some snacks.
Right, right.
Maybe,
yeah.
Maybe it'll come out to 12 RMB, right? And then right when that 12 comes up on the little register, an older lady comes out of the back, starts yelling. She's like yelling at the guy at the register, and he's just some happy old man. He looks a little scared. And then all of a sudden the price goes up to 24. And you think, wow, that's weird. huh, what happened there? But, you know, being in China for about a day and not being very comfortable with the environment, I'm like, okay, this is my tax.
So that's just what happens. They see you and they just assume, ah, he can afford it. He doesn't speak the lingo. He'll just do it.
Yeah, I think that part of it is that it's not just me being white. Like, I'm not trying to be racist here, guys.
It's just that you're an outlander and they know that you don't know what the fuck's going on.
They can tell. They're looking at me like, this guy has no idea what's going on. He spent like 5 minutes trying to read a label. He clearly can't. take him for all he's worth.
Dude, that's fucking real capitalism right there. That's just like, wait, you can't read the labels? All right, 100% extra. Label outdated.
I think China does it better than us. They're a little more cutthroat. It's same way with driving, man.
Oh,
I actually got frustrated coming back here, and we were driving. It was the day I got back. And
what, you just didn't want to follow the rules? You just wanted to be that?
Yeah. Yeah. No one cares over there. Like, I'm walking, and it's a green pedestrian light, and people are just like, what does that mean? I don't know. And just running the red lights like nothing. Everybody's going everywhere.
With the motorbikes are the scary part. Like, they're just weaving in between sidewalk and road. Like, cars and people just all terrain, man. They don't give a shit.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially the scooters, though. There's no place that I saw scooters fail to go. I mean, they were literally like, I mean, there was one in the lobby of the hotel. I mean, like, I'm surprised they didn't put it in the elevator, but it's a little scary at first, but once you start to get that trust, I think the big mistake people make, these people around me were making, was they would walk and they'd see a motorcyclist coming, and you'd do that little like kind of dance where you're, am I going to go left or right? Should I keep going slower, faster?
Yeah.
What are you going to do? Just keep your pace and they'll keep theirs and everything's cool.
Yeah. You gotta hear. No, you're right.
It seems like they forget that here. It's like everybody's very skittish and scared.
Like, well, everybody does that, like, you're taught defensive driving. So everyone's reaction is like, when in doubt, just hit the brakes and stop. You know, when in doubt, assess the situation. China's more like, fucking you do you, and if you don't run into anybody else, we're all good. If we all say, let's not run into anybody else, and we all do our own shit, then we're good.
So, well, there's not even that when in doubt conversation. Like, no one ever tells you, oh, when everybody in doubt, just you want to pump your brakes. Like, no one ever even tells you that. You just, like, I guess you just line up and you get your license and you just go.
Yeah.
There's, like, no test. You just get out there and you just go for it. And
that's it, huh? You just show up. I want to drive. I think I'd like it. So I guess if you can afford a car, it's kind of one of those things, right?
I don't know that I'm ready for that there, though. That's all.
No, I'm not trying to drive.
Behind the wheel is a different story. Being a pedestrian, you see it from third person, it's different. But maybe next time. Yeah, maybe next time we're both in China, we can get a car, rent a car, and drive around, haggle with some people. That'd be great.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever driven outside of the country, and I don't really want to. It's pretty damn scary. Shanghai is definitely a cool city. I know it's very modern. They have a lot of cool stuff. But how was the pollution for you when you guys were there? Was it bad? Did you wear a mask?
So the first few days, for one, I thought I should bring masks, and that I was going to wear them.
If I was invited, I would have, I think.
Yeah, that was something I had on my list of things to prepare with. And I, classic fashion, I just didn't get most of my list. You know, first international trip, I have no idea what I'm doing. I don't know how to pack. I don't know how to do anything. So I forgot very minimal stuff. I'm pretty happy with it. But I didn't get a mask. The pollution was pretty low, actually, the first few days. So almost the first whole week, it was very clear. I kept telling people, like, is this as bad as it gets? Because, like, I hear a lot of crap about Shanghai smog, and this is not bad. And then you really started to see it towards, like, the last 3 or 4 days of the event.
Yeah.
Where you lose sight of some buildings you saw a few days ago and stuff, so.
I think it has to do with, like, wind patterns and, like, there's trends in the pollution and stuff. There's all sorts of fluctuations, but when it's bad, dude, it's... There were a few days when I was there where it's, like, the sky is fucking brown. Like, I can see the smog. What the hell is happening here?
So where were you when you came for DSC?
We were in Shanghai, but it was at the Olympic Stadium.
Oh, okay. I think that's like an hour north or something like that. So it's still like in Shanghai, though. Yeah.
Yeah, it was still in Shanghai. I think it's pretty far away from the Pearl.
It, you know, it honestly wasn't that bad. I felt like it was the same thing with Seattle, where you go and all you hear about is rain. And then, like, you're there for all of TI and it rains.
Apparently,
like
that
half
one's
a
not
day.
True anymore. Apparently, the Seattle raining thing is an old adage that used to be true, and now the weather patterns have changed, and it's not the rainy city anymore. Like, it literally, climate change and shit, man. Like, it don't rain.
So they're gonna do like a rebranding process.
They need to. When I was there for TI5, I asked a bunch of the Uber drivers, and they all said, "Yeah, man, the last like 5 years, it doesn't rain anymore. That's like a thing." And then, you know, they're all fucking liberals. They're just like, global warming. And then they give you candy and you get out and go, wow, Seattle's a different place.
I think we're missing a few steps in there. But yeah, candy.
Dude, you can judge a city by the Uber drivers. And Seattle is the only city that I've been in where multiple Uber drivers have just had bags of candy and mints and bottled water. One of them gave me a goddamn Starbucks gift card for no reason.
Okay, that's way out of line.
Like I showed up and he picked me up somewhere and he was just like, oh, where are you going? I'm like, oh, the hotel, I'm here for this event, this and that. He's just like, really? That's awesome, man. Here you go. Enjoy a Starbucks on me. I was like, what the fuck, man? I don't think I spent it, actually. I felt weird.
I mean, if the Uber driver's giving away Starbucks gift cards with his water bottles, you take it.
I took the gift card. I just think it rotted in my wallet for 3 years and then probably expired. Actually, that's probably illegal in Seattle. I'm sure gift cards don't expire there. What am I talking about? Let's not get crazy.
That's like the home of Starbucks, right? I mean, they know gift cards.
Mm-hmm. It's true. That's why everyone's obsessed with it. They're like, yeah, we got fucking Kurt Cobain. We got Starbucks. We got the gum wall. What else could you want?
We'll have rain in a few years. Just wait.
All right, so pollution wasn't so bad. Everything else is okay. Get into the nitty gritty. What were you actually doing over there? You were like this ominous production. So what did that actually entail once you arrived?
Yeah, speaking of ominous, when Brian first announced that he was going to Shanghai, and we got invited at the same time, I saw his tweet. I saw the feedback on it. And he got a few questions like, you know, what are you going to be doing in Shanghai? And, you know, Brian's experienced. He's been around the block, definitely more than I have. He's been to TI, he's worked TI. He's done a lot of events, and he's really built a lot of things from the ground up as well. So I felt like he had a better handle on it. And his feedback wasn't going so hot. So I thought, I don't know what the hell I'm doing in that kind of public-facing aspect. I'm just going to go ahead and keep this one to myself. And at the time, I didn't have my visa and passport ready, so I wasn't even sure if I was going to go.
Right.
And I said, screw it. I'll just kind of keep this one under the belt. Well, we were both hired to be production consultants. That was literally all the information that we had been given.
That's it.
About a week in, we got a gear list. A week out of the event, actually. We got a list of what kind of gear they'd have. We could do a little research and whatnot. And that was about it.
Okay.
So, you know, we got there. Everything seemed good. We had some dinner, you know, snuggled into the hotel rooms. And we did a little bit of a rehearsal the night before.
Okay.
And from what we saw, things were okay. Things seemed good. You know, they had the equipment there and everything looks like it should be fine. But, you know, you never know the intricacies of the wiring and stuff till later. So, you know, there were a few issues, to say the least. It's the kind of thing where you can't, there's no way you can check everything in the amount of time that you're there beforehand. You know, we have like less than a day. We can't check every single cable and plug. It's gear we're unfamiliar with. So we kind of have to make sure that things run smoothly after they don't, rather than preemptively fix these problems. The only real way we can
do
anything
also,
about them is fixing them. So
it's like a difference in perspective, right? Like, you, me, and Brian all have, like, some experience building studios on a smaller scale. Like, wiring up the Summit House is a challenge that takes planning and thoughtfulness, but it's pretty achievable. You can kind of map it out in your head and mark all the cables, know where it's going. When you're talking about a venue like this, it is an absurd amount of cables. And if you're not there when they're being run and the person that did it didn't label them or color code or do anything, you're just, it's like doing computer programming and walking into somebody's project that isn't commented or tested. And you're just like, what the fuck is going
on
here?
That's exactly what it is. Everything's connected. There's all these references. There's all these cables going like every different direction. and they're all thrown together in a big trunk, and they're just flying through doorways and rooms, and like, who knows what goes where? You want to trace something, and it's going to be hell. Like, I don't think there was a single time we actually traced a cable, like any English speakers, because it was just impossible. It got to the point where, towards the end of day one, there was just so many issues consistently that we decided we needed to stay late. We needed to like just fix almost every problem that we could. We had a long meeting, ended at like 1:30, had some other people other than Brian and I working on it overnight.
Yeah.
So that it would be ready in the morning.
What was the first big tech issue? I'm like confusing main event from group stage. When you guys first arrived, what was the very first like big tech issue when the broadcast started? Was it mostly audio stuff? Well,
let me just say.
Okay.
Because Shanghai is, you know, it's a widely discussed topic. There's a lot of drama with it. I worked with Bonnie, who I hadn't really worked with before. I'd met her like once at one of the summits, but that was all.
Right.
She was great. I think she did a good job.
Bonnie, right? Same one. The cosplayer.
Sorry, I missed that.
Said Piecat and Bonnie.
Yeah,
that Bonnie.
Yes, that's the okay. One. And yeah, she was great. She did a good job, and I don't think she's typically used to doing what she did there. So for what it was.
Was she hired as a translator or?
Yes, I believe, as far as I know, she was hired as a translator. Okay. Essentially, what she ended up doing was translating the entire production crew and all the gear and equipment and the directing and all that stuff. So she was like kind of she was essentially the bottleneck between Brian and I, and then the English speakers from Valve.
Right. Because that's how many people, like how many English speakers and how many like Chinese speakers in the production?
It's
quite a few.
At the start, day one and two, Key TV was working there. And that consisted of roughly like somewhere between 12 and 14 guys in the production room. All their team, like speaking strictly Mandarin.
Right.
And then you have also Weppus or Scriff in the corner and Scant doing stats right next to him.
Okay, I
see. Doesn't leave much room for anybody else. And then you add Bonnie on top of that, standing in the middle of it. A lot of issues, you know, like, for instance, the observer didn't have headphones, but there's speakers in the room, but there's, you know, 15 people talking and things like that. Very simple oversights where I think that the experience of having run any kind of Dota event before really shines through more so than some other types of experience in that situation.
Yeah.
Where just knowing some of the things we need from a Dota standpoint rather than just a production standpoint.
Yeah. Well, that was like, that's what I gathered talking to Brian or K-Poptosis, just even a little bit at Frankfurt. It was like, originally I was kind of brought in to do stats, and then it just became apparent to everyone that there was a need for someone that understands just basic Dota shit. Like the stuff that when we talk about planning an event, we don't even mention because it's all just assumed, like, duh, we're going to do Dota TV, you know, like, duh, we're not going to take pictures of the players smoking, you know, like all of these sort of things. And to a general production company, they might have some super sick gear and camera shots and all this stuff, but somebody still has to interface the basics. Like there's some credence when you're mapping out a big event like this of just having a couple of people that, I don't want to say have like an undefined job, but are just like understand Dota and production enough that they can help interface it together so really obvious basic things don't get fucked up. And I feel like a lot of people haven't really thought of that as like a good use of paying somebody for their time. But every event, there are people that are like, I wasn't hired for this, but I had to put out all these fires, you know?
Somebody did think of that. Whoever it was, I don't know who you are out there. Someone thought, you know what would be good? And I don't know, maybe it was just gods that pushed for it and then someone just caved, or that's probably more likely than someone actively thinking, oh, let's be proactive and bring some people along that could put out fires. That probably didn't occur to them. You know, maybe it did, considering how many fire extinguishers they had at the venue.
Well, it's also a little counterintuitive because you have to sort of admit that there will be fires, but you're admitting that it's not going to be perfect by saying that. You know,
admitting things is not the strong suit of the Chinese workforce, I'll tell you that. So Thinking back now, going back to that production room, there was roughly 12 plus people in there usually. And day one and two with KTV working, it was just really hard to get anything changed. There's so many people in there that clearly weren't doing anything. so very clearly. Like, it's not like they're on their phone. Like, they're literally just like sleeping in their seat. It's like, you don't need to be in this room doing that. A lot of people were taking pictures towards like the main event and stuff of the people sleeping. And I don't necessarily think that's cool because people were working hard and sleeping and trying to get some rest. And like, everybody takes a nap once in a while, like, you know, give them some breaks. But it's a difference when you're like actually kind of becoming a nuisance sleeping. Like, you can't just be like sleeping in the hallway or like sleeping on the video switch or something. So
dude, when I was there, there was heightened security. So there were extra security guards, and so many of them were just visibly sleeping. And it's like, you're wearing a uniform, you know, like they're quote unquote on guard or whatever. And they're just in a chair, hat over the eyes, arms crossed, just passed out, literally snoring. It's like, how is this not an issue? How does this work?
I think they just don't have break rooms, right? So
I guess
it's like, all right, hey, buddy, I'm going to take over for you for 8 hours. So you go right over like 5 feet away right there. And there's a chair and you just zonk out, man. Just take a nap.
Maybe it's like sort of along a similar vein of why people smoke in the bathroom. Cause it's regarded as, you know, you're quote taking a break if you go for a cigarette break. But if you go to the bathroom and then take an extra few minutes and smoke a cigarette after you piss, it's just regarded as a long trip to the bathroom, not a break from work, so you don't look lazy, you know. Like,
that actually makes a lot of sense.
If you think about it from that perspective, it's sort of fitting,
because there would be restrooms with clearly marked signs that, I mean, almost everywhere is clearly marked not to smoke. It doesn't really matter, but literally right next to a smoking area, and people would smoke in the bathroom at the hotel. I'm thinking, like, isn't it just convenient for you to smoke outside of the bathroom?
It's very jarring the first time you see it. And you're like, wait, is there a party in here? What the hell's going on, boys?
Like, why are there two people smoking in this bathroom when right outside there's like a nice sitting area and like an ashtray? Like, it actually seems like they're trying to use this room. I don't understand it, but I guess. Well, I did take up smoking while I was there, I'll be honest.
Oh, that's good. I smoked a few cigarettes when I was there, but I really regretted it because the pollution bugged me and I had a real bad cough, and I'm pretty sure the cigarettes did not help.
Yeah, so not being a commentator helps me, I guess. I don't have to be talking all day, every day, so I can kind
of... Well, I wasn't there to cast, remember. You guys were doing the coverage from the house, and I was there just basically being project manager for content and doing media.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking to people and doing interviews and stuff.
There was a lot of talking. You know me.
Oh, yeah. Never ends. So that it was kind of nice. I figured, you know, I'm in China. It's been a few years since I smoked. There's a lot of smokers here. It's like one in two, I think, of every male adults.
It's that,
like, one in three of all adults or something like that. It's crazy.
Oh my God. That's unbelievable, dude. That's, you just think about how many raw cigarettes that country imports and produces. Like, that's insane.
Right. Yeah. It's not even about like the number of people. It's like, think about how many cigarettes. Like, most of those people also probably smoke somewhat heavily.
What do they do with all the butts?
Oh, dude, I know exactly where those go. They go straight on the ground. There's a song about that. You throw it on the ground. That's exactly what you do. And they don't seem to care. I try to use ashtrays. I'm a polite person, I feel.
Yeah. No.
Screw it. Really, what are you going to do? There's just so much of it over there. It's rampant.
I remember being in one of the hotels. I think it was the Pullman, at one of the Pullmans. And there was an ashtray and a pack of matches and a sign that said no smoking. And I asked one of the attendants there, like, what's the deal with that? Isn't that a mixed signal? And he said, well, you're not really supposed to smoke. But if you want to smoke, no one's going to stop you. So we'd rather you maybe put some of it in the ashtray than just throw it on the floor. I'm like, oh. So it's more of just it's like the pirate code. It's really just a guideline. It's like, well, if you want to, don't smoke. But if you want to, fuck it.
I mean, the main smoking area, right, in the Marriott when we were doing the group stages, or like the initial, was there's just like two smoke detectors, no smoking signs. And every time I light a cigarette, I'm looking up like, why is the smoke detector not working? Like, I know that's a smoke detector. Like, I know this is China, but that's definitely still a smoke detector. I don't know, they have a different way of doing things over there. But okay. It's kind of refreshing. You know, I enjoyed my time.
Oh, I love
over
it,
there,
dude. That's why I love traveling. I love seeing how other cultures do stuff. And it's like, you know, some people get a little uptight about like people making fun of their cultures. And I always feel like, listen, man, I love when people make fun of Americans because so much dumb shit happens in America. And it's fun to be able to sort of, it's very humbling to look at all the dumb shit that your culture does and really cool shit that other cultures do. One of the things that I still never understood was the security to get into the building at DAC. It was a big metal detector and they had a little thing, you know, to put like bags through or where you would normally put change or a cell phone in. But when you would go through, if you start to take stuff out of your pockets, they would say no and say just walk through the metal detector. So obviously it goes off every single time.
Yes.
And then they pull you aside and give you the magic wand thing. It beeps every single time because you have metal in your pockets. And then they just wave you on and said, okay, you're good. And they don't pat you down. And I'm just like, well, what could you possibly be searching for here? Does it beep if there isn't metal? Like, what? I don't.
Okay, so. So Scriff and I would go out and smoke like a lot, and the way to the smoking area, you had to go through that exact thing you just described. Was there was a thing to check your bag, and they would take your lighter every time as well. You weren't allowed to take lighters in the arena. So
okay,
and those would beep. And the first time I went through, security seemed legit. Like you described it perfectly, except that people seemed to be paying attention day one.
Yeah,
and then like. Halfway through day one, I went to go for a smoke break, and like they stopped caring. I don't know what happened. Maybe the people that care were asleep, but it was exactly as you described. They wave you in, you beep, they like look at you. Sometimes they wouldn't even wand you. They're like, whatever, like just get in there, just go. Well,
I remember they stopped Ryan like the day before the finals, the main event. And he had the same gear that he brought in every day and all the camera stuff. And he had one of those like multi-tools that had a knife on it. And I guess they finally noticed it on the x-ray machine. And they pulled it out and they stopped and they opened up the blade. And they had like five people looking at it and they were measuring it and stuff. And then they just gave it back to him and let him in. That was the only time we had a potential security breach.
Wow.
But then they just gave it back. So
it's Ryan, right?
Yeah, like long hair, fucking, you know, he looks like a crazy like fucking metal singer or something. I can only imagine what they were saying about him.
Oh, Steve Aoki's knife. It's like, oh, that's...
Oh, shit, Steve Aoki's in China. What's up? Oh, God. All right, so tell us about the production, man. I'm really curious about what you actually did. Were you pulling levers? So you said you were working with Bonnie a bit. Were you just kind of running logistics? Were you mostly putting out fires?
I think the fires thing. We were definitely... Brian and I were firemen at this event more so than anything else. After the discovery of KTV leaving, being escorted out, we essentially needed to take over the production entirely. So Brian and I kind of bucked up and said, we're not consultants anymore. We're going to jump in here and make this happen because there's no one else to do it.
Right.
So the initial day three, they were still in the production room clearing out their gear. KTV was at 9 a.m. when the actual broadcast was supposed to be starting. So right. There was an initial delay on day three. And if you go back and watch the broadcast, day three actually runs a lot smoother than the rest of the event because it was me, Brian, Bruno, and if you know, Tad from Valve as well. It was just us in there. There was no need for translation. We could understand the panel. We knew what we were doing. We were on, you know, everybody had their roles. We had four people instead of like 14.
So that was the day that it started pretty much on time, but there was just no panel for like the first series, right?
Correct.
And then it picked up. Yeah, we did that. I don't know if you guys even knew, like we were wondering if anybody in China even knew what we were doing, but we did what we called the emergency power panel. And for that first series, we turned on the Moonduck stream, did a little pre-show, and then as soon as the game started, turned the stream off and hosted the major. As soon as the game ends, turn the stream back on, do a panel. As soon as the game starts, turn it off and host the major. And we did that, until you guys got the panel up. And then we said, all right, cool. The panel's back. See ya. And then we all went to bed. Did you even know that we did that?
No idea. Oh, I mean, cool. Thanks, I guess.
No, it's not a, it's just more like we were like, well, shit. It's just downtime between the games. Let's fucking do a panel. I'm in.
That's one of those things that I miss. I like jumping on like, oh, emergency cast. Let's do it. Like that.
Yeah.
You know, when I did amateur stuff, I would do that kind of stuff every once in a while. Like, this is a cool opportunity no one's doing. Let's just do it. Like, that sounds
yeah.
fun.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, we were a little bit nervous. Like, we talked about it for a while. Like, are people going to be pissed off by this? Like, are the talent there going to feel like we're trying to make a joke out of it? Or like, you know, and after we kicked it back and forth, like, that's when we came up with the idea of just turning it off and hosting the major. Like, all right, we're not going to do anything over the stream at all. Like, we're only going to do our stream when they are literally at just a static screen with downtime. And it seemed like that was like definitely the right approach. And it seemed like people at least appreciated the effort from what we did, even though it was like, you know, a total of like an hour and a half of content or something. It really wasn't that big of a deal, but it was still fun. You know, it felt oddly good to be like, hey guys, you know what? We're kind of the only ones that aren't stuck in China right now without a production team. Why don't we fucking step up and try and do something? It felt kind of good to contribute from afar, even though it was still a pretty minor thing, you know?
Absolutely. I appreciate it because when there isn't coverage here and we're stuck in a situation where we don't have any options and we're trying our best to fix it and make it work again so that everybody can actually experience this, you guys are like ready, standing by like, you know what? No one's doing this. Let's get on it so at least someone can see it. Like, at some point down the line, it's not even about competition anymore. It's just like everybody wants to see the Dota. Everybody wants to like experience what's happening and have fun with it and just watch. So it's good that you guys are there for that.
Yeah. No, it's good. I think you're right.
During
it helps
that time. Oh. We were literally just sitting there like putting out fires, making sure that the baseline equipment was like working. It was pretty rough initially, but after a few hours of us just jumping in, testing the gear, making sure everything was right, day three ran really smooth. Like by the end of the day, we had some new initiates we were training that would be, I guess they had worked, I don't know what their studio name was or organization or anything like that, but they had worked some League of Legends events before. So they seemed like they knew some esports related production specifics. They seemed like they tried a bit harder. They had a bit more passion than Key TV and some pride in their work, which helps a lot.
Yeah. I don't know much about Key TV. I don't know how involved they are, like video game stuff, but if you're a production company that sort of has been sort of like BTS, right? Like it started when it wasn't fun, when it was more of a grind than it was making money or really, you know, the question of, is this thing going to be successful is like in the back of your mind every day when you're grinding through broadcasts. And if you're able to grind through that and become like a real production studio that's like buying studio quality gear and renting out commercial space and stuff, you have just a whole different perspective and passion for what you're doing in gaming than a top tier production company that just sees it as another paycheck, you know, because they just don't give a fuck. It's just another gig to them. And if you're a true gamer that's gone through that grind, it's not just another gig for you. It's like, it's your fucking shit. You know, you want everybody to appreciate gaming.
That was one of my big complaints about the team initially is, When we heard that they were let go, which, by the way, we did kind of get this news via the Reddit post. Like, Brian and I initially found out about the confirmation of Key TV being removed from the Reddit post where Gabe also called James an ass. So it was a big morning.
So you guys didn't have any extra info on site. You were basically like the rest of us and just woke up and went,
here's what happened. We would get into the group stage hotel like pretty early, like 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning or something.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, maybe even a little earlier. And we'd start running around, you know, making sure that the casting rooms were set up and whatnot. And then Brian says, Rob, come here. I need to tell you something that you're going to tell your grandchildren. And I thought, whoa, that's a statement right there. What's going on, Brian? And initially I'm like a little unsure, like who says that?
Yeah.
And then he shows me the post and I read the whole thing and I'm just speechless for 30 seconds or so thinking, you know, I've read things like this before that are, they were close to this maybe. But I've never read something like this in my life. and been in the middle of it and thought, wow, things are heating up. So
yeah.
I told him I need a minute. I just need a minute. Give me a minute. I'll walk. I'll take a loop. I'll come back. We'll figure this out and we'll get right on it. So I go in the other room. I go in like an empty conference room and just start. I take a quick video, like a reaction to myself. I should get it, but whatever, later. And I'm floored. Like half the video is me just sitting there silent, like looking off in the distance. In between statements of me going, oh, so wow. yeah, and eventually we got back together with Brian, synced up with Bruno and Tad, and we all kind of decided our roles. Brian was kind of making sure, he was kind of assuming a director role and like taking command of everything. I was essentially running around doing what I normally do. I'm like, kind of like the everyman. Do a little everything, but I was doing stage management, some audio, right. Generally fixing the tech problems that would come up, whereas Bruno and Tad were doing video and audio switching.
Right.
So between the four of us, we kind of had everything covered. We were doing very light like graphics at first because we had to relearn that system.
Mm-hmm.
Some of our assets were all of a sudden missing that morning as well after the
And is most of this gear all in Chinese or is some of it in English or at least like so, you can swap it?
It's all labeled in Chinese, like with handwritten labels and stuff, but it is typically in English gear-wise. So like all the printed stuff on the gear is typically in English, but there's not a whole lot that's that's too foreign there. Like it's your typical stuff on a soundboard. You've got your compression and your you know, all that stuff. So
I guess you're right. The gear is gear at some point. You either know how it works or you don't.
Yeah, and it was mostly in English, so it was doable. But it was the kind of thing where we sat down and we realized, man, this is actually so much easier with like four or five people.
Yeah.
Instead of like 15 in here where you actually can't move. You're trying to tell someone across the room something and you can't. So you have to wiggle through five people to get there. And
dude, we've all been through that. Like at BTS, there are times where it's like, dude, there are just too many fucking people giving opinions on this. I'm out. You guys figure it out. And sometimes that's what you need to do. Just leave it between two people to figure out. When everyone's trying to like give their two cents and run around, it creates more chaos when you have all that clutter and all these people trying to do really specific jobs. It gets hard to manage.
Yeah, I think that maybe there's too specific a job direction. Like, there are people just sitting there that seem to have one job only. And when that's not happening, they will just go back into default mode, which is sit there and do nothing. And it just seems so very odd to me. There's a lack of proactive thinking in a lot of the work environments where people don't do anything unless it's a reaction to something else. And if you're able to please your boss, that's really all that matters because no one else is paying your rent. You know, it's just like, I want to make sure the hand that feeds loves me and that's all.
Yeah.
And that's what I hated about the initial production team and so many of the people there that I was working with, is that they had that mindset so often.
Well, that's definitely just a difference in work culture.
Yes, it is.
Talking to people from that area of the world. But it's also hard, particularly in that live environment, for two main reasons. One, because everything is time sensitive. So any like just kind of bureaucratic red tape that gets in your way is more frustrating than it would be normally because you know there's thousands of people watching live. And you're like, the sooner we fix this, the sooner our headaches go away. So there's always that extra added bit of time pressure, ASAP. And it also is frustrating because you can't easily troubleshoot where the problem's coming from when there are that many people that have a hand in the mix. Where it's like, well, where was the breakdown here? And everyone has an excuse as to why it's not directly their fault. And it's like, well, it was no one specific person's fault, but it was also nobody's responsibility to make sure this shit didn't happen. And then fixing it becomes this whole rigmarole of, you know, all right, now whose job description gets altered to prevent this from happening again? And it, God damn it, you know, you just wish you had one or two really trustworthy people that are willing to go above and beyond and just be like, Rob, can you just fucking deal with this, please? And know that you can actually deal with it.
And that's precisely what I think they don't have there, really, is those people. Or not many of them. You know, I'm generalizing a bit. But there was one guy that I was just so taken aback with. I think it was day four of the main event. It was the new team that we had, like, trained during the end of the the group stage stuff, and he actually found a translator, brought them over to me, told the translator to ask me to specifically change something about a microphone that Sindarin was wearing. And I stood there with my mouth open saying, like, I can't believe, like, this is amazing. Like, absolutely, I'll go out there and run out there and do that. Like, that's, someone's actually taking the time and effort and energy to go and think, like, something isn't as good as it could be. Let's try and make it better. And it really showed me, like, there are people there that can really do that and that can be proactive. And, you know, it was really frustrating because up until then, there really weren't many people that were willing to do that kind of thing. It was one of those things where all it takes is one time and you kind of regain hope in humanity.
No, I feel like people like us sort of that have been involved in esports or whatever and just sort of have that kind of mentality are a little bit spoiled in terms of there are a lot of people out there that don't think that way about just being proactive and that wholesome, like, is this good for me? How is this good for me relative to how it's good for everybody else? Like, is this, you know, if I take this, is someone else going to be up? So a lot of people are just sort of in that zone of their own world, their own perspective, and fuck everything else. I've kind of got blinders on about what's happening in the periphery. But in esports, you can't really think that way. It just doesn't work because if you do, you get left behind. You miss out on opportunities. And pretty much anyone who's anyone in esports at this point, the people that we work with on a daily basis are fucking proactive as hell. They're always looking for the next best thing. They're always thinking about where they are, where they want to be, how they can get there, what the best way to get. Like, you have to have that forethought to make it here. And we're definitely spoiled by that, dude. The real world is not filled with people that have that mindset. It's one of the reasons why I don't know if I can go back to having a real job ever. If this whole esports thing dries up, I don't know what the fuck I'm going to do, man. I'm too used to working out at home in my undies.
You know, I'm getting in a scary place too, where I'm sort of getting used to it, feeling the same way.
Yeah.
Where, like, I'll go into like a retail store and think, never again. This just cannot happen. Like, I interact with the cashier and I can just see the malaise in their eyes. They just don't want to be there. And I think, God, I am lucky that I wake up every morning and I'm like, this is cool.
Slacks told me that he went to Denny's on Christmas last year to get some food. And when the girl rang up the order, she started crying, was like, I have kids. I had to work on Christmas Eve.
Holy
and he's just
shit.
Like, Jesus, I kind of feel bad, but I kind of just want to get my fucking hotcakes and get out of here. I was
God.
Epitomizes American consumerism to a T right there.
Ugh. Yeah, that's it. That's it right there in the flesh. I mean, that's bad, man. But it happens just all too often.
Widespread. It really does. Wow. Well, you know, one of the things about the Shanghai Major that I was really happy with, I mean, honestly, the Dota itself was pretty good. Now, there are a lot of top tier games. There are a lot of cool storylines that erupted with the NA teams doing well, two SEA teams getting top six, all that kind of stuff. The game's pretty action packed. But I was really glad that towards the end of the event, things were finally rolling. Like, production was finally, I was going to say down, but, you know, like, you had it down. Like, the kinks were worked out. By the end, it was kind of a regular tournament for most, you know, for your average viewer. You know, the production was on point, the panel was there and lively and all that kind of stuff. And it was nice that despite all that ridiculousness, all those hardships, you guys were still able to bring it together and have a fucking major. You know, it still went on. It's not like the major got canceled. And I think a lot of people got caught up in how bad it was, and it's like how much worse it could have been if you guys didn't get all that shit fixed in a pressure cooker, you know?
Well, I'm just glad to hear it from your perspective, since you weren't there and you kind of feel that same way, is that everything did feel like it got drowned out, especially with the whole initial James firing and this and that. It kind of front-loaded a lot of the drama, so that's what people were talking about instead of the games. And then it gets into the main... Well, initially we started with tech problems, and then that's some drama. And then we get James, and then we get into the main event, and... You know, there's just more problems, and that's what I got worried about. Towards the end of the group stages, you know, we started getting it on point. We were feeling good about it. Day three and four, we thought this is really running great, but towards the end of day three, I just started having this kind of realization. Every time I'd get in a place where I was alone, maybe I'd be going up and down the elevator, and I'd get in the elevator, and the doors would close, and immediately my mind would just do you realize that in 3 days... We're supposed to be running an event out of the Mercedes-Benz Arena. It just, my head cracks a little bit. I'm surprised it didn't break down that. I actually, people would come up to me and say, are you right? Are you stressed? And I think, well, you know, we just took over production for this huge event that we've never really done this, anything close to this size before. And, you know, there's a lot going on. There's a lot at stake. And yet, I'm not really stressed. What's wrong with me? I think I was just telling myself constantly, like, you know, it's okay. The nice part about this is that if you screw up, it really can't get worse.
Yeah,
so like,
dude.
Of all the situations to be thrown into, I think this was almost the best that you could even set up.
You're like the ultimate underdog because not many people there know you or come in with high expectations. You're like the helper guy. The event's a disaster for the most part. Any net gain that you give, any value added is just like, well, fuck yeah, Rob. Thanks for doing good. Everyone else just fucked off. So
it was like fucking Complexity's run in Shanghai, dude. But yeah, it had that feeling where every time something would get fixed and it just continued to run smooth throughout the event, it just felt so much better. Slowly you could just chip away at all the weight on your shoulders. At the start of the main event, you know, the casting booths didn't even work. Like they just didn't work. I mean, I wish I had taken pictures of
the cable.
No
computers or like no monitors or what do you like?
The wiring and the audio was just, I never seen something even close to that.
Was it like Major All-Stars where they gave Velat a table and a computer and then no Ethernet cord? And when he asked for one, they said, wait, you need to go on the internet? He's like, what did you think I was going to do with these computers? Why don't you use the Wi-Fi?
That was our analyst desk. At the casting desk, they had Wi-Fi on the laptops, which at least was internet. Pretty spotty, but it worked. But the casting desk didn't get used the first 2 days of the main event until I think towards the end of the day two or maybe three. I spent a lot of time personally. Like, if there's one thing I could say that I made happen at the event, and I guess this is going on the record, is that I made those goddamn casting booths work, at least the English one. It took a lot of effort and time just getting the gear kind of reset, and there were some really weird cabling issues, a lot of loopback. Production kind of didn't know how they were doing the sound run through and stuff, and so it took some break time, and that's hard to do during games. That's what people don't realize, is that you'll be watching a stream and maybe there's a weird sound, there's a beep, you know, the classic beep or some crunching sound or something. For one, we don't get to hear that for 6 minutes because of a mandatory stream delay in China. That's like government issued.
Because like they have actual laws against betting and stuff.
Now,
it's a big
deal.
The funny
part is they think they're able to screen the stream, as in like they see it and then it runs out 6 minutes later. So if something crazy happens, they can cut it.
Right.
But like, we tried to explain to people, after about a few sentences, we were so fed up with it. We're like, we're not even going to bother explaining. Let's just put it at 6 minutes and just let it be.
Right.
Because there's no way, once it goes out to the stream, even if it goes out in 6 minutes, it's going out.
No, the Twitch delay server doesn't work that way. Like, theoretically, a delay server can work that way where you can kill the stream and anything that hasn't gone live yet gets deleted. But
it's like TV.
But Twitch doesn't do that. That's not how the Twitch delay works. Once it's out there, it's through the system and it's done. So,
So, essentially, that was kind of an issue for troubleshooting, because anytime there's a problem, you know, we have to wait 6 minutes, we hear the problem, and then we have to figure out what the problem is without any kind of real way to troubleshoot it. And that's just during the day during games. So you can't do a whole hell of a lot unless it's before the stream or after the stream. So that doesn't leave a whole lot of time for troubleshooting. And we tried to do as best we could in between the games, but and we had delays, so there was some time. And the time where we really needed to fix things, the times where we thought, okay, we'll just wait till the next delay and we'll get in there and we'll fix this. And that was when we didn't have delays, which it felt like a win-win. You know, people were getting stressed, and I'd always try and be the happy Rob role where I just go around happy-go-lucky and just kind of cheer people up. And there were a lot of times where like Bruno or Tad or Brian or LD or whoever was just frustrated. And I'm like, it's fine, buddy. We're doing it. It's gonna be okay. Because sometimes you just need some motivation, and it just all seems too much.
No, you gotta stay positive, because once like talents start to shut down and people just like in general are just depressed, everything gets harder. It gets harder to get talent motivated. It gets harder to communicate with talent. It gets harder for production to communicate with each other. Like, it's actually super important to keep morale high and at least have some people that are trying to be positive. Because if everyone is realistic and negative and, you know, talks about how it really is, it's like, well, guys, let's just cry in a corner and then go home. You know, you got to stay positive to get through all that shit.
Yeah. And people in chat are helping me remember how positive we had to stay during the Mafia games. My God. Us being the bottom two and three, we should get Owen in here.
Oh.
Do a little something.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Mafia. It took me a second. Yeah. Zyori looked like a retard at Mafia. That's harsh, dude. That's fucking
Shout
harsh.
Shout out to Nat. Disgrace. He
National
definitely
disgrace,
did look
dude.
Like a retard. That's great.
I mean, I'm not that good at Mafia. I mean, I like the game on a more basic. I feel outclassed by a lot of the people there. Jesus.
You know what we played in Shanghai was Werewolf, and that is really fun compared to Mafia. Actually.
Is it really that different? People always told me that they're
very fun.
The same.
I think for us non tryhards, because I know you're not into the super tryhard Mafia. It's definitely more fun. Everybody gets a role. There's tons of meta roles that are like one of the games I played is Little Girl, and you get to peek during the Mafia phase. Like, you can look, you can just see who the Mafia is. But if they see you, they insta kill you. Like, things like that and they make the game totally different than what you normally get playing typical Mafia. So
okay,
it's pretty fun.
I like that. I want to try it now. I know you guys have been playing a lot of board games over at BTS, and I tried a new one. Have you ever played Puerto Rico?
I have not.
We played it in Phoenix. It's like Settlers of Catan, but with like four more layers of strategy, where it's like it's about resource management, but you have to like get workers and you have to get farms, and before you can produce stuff, you have to have a place to store it. So it's like Settlers of Catan, but less RNG.
Sorta? Like Agricola, maybe?
Oh, I've never played Agricola, but I think it's of a similar kind of mantra. Apparently, it's one of the top five board games ever, so...
Whoa.
Get fucked.
I'll have to look into that one. Damn.
Puerto Rico. We played it in Phoenix at Captain's Draft 3. It was pretty fun. I enjoy. I'm not a huge board game guy, as you know, but if I enjoyed it... Although, Mott got really mad because Slacks and Grant just... They became the Corn Barons, and all they did was corn stuff. And Mock got mad that they weren't taking the game seriously, and it got pretty funny.
That sounds about right. The Corn Barons.
Oh. Corn! More corn! Yeah, that was basically the entire stream. It was just Slacks yelling about corn. Some of my real-life friends watched it, and they were just like, I don't know who that Slacks guy is, but he's pretty funny. I'm like, thanks.
You
I'll
know,
tell him you said
I had
that.
A lot of friends, real-life friends, tune into the Summit 4. And they gave me exactly the opposite. They basically, like, their only feedback, because my friends are assholes, and they're never going to see this video, so fuck all my friends. Anyways, so they said, you know, oh, the Summit, that's cool, Rob, but who's this fucking Slacks guy? God help him. God, please shut him up, or whatever. Like, regardless of what it was just always negative towards Slacks. Like, I was like... Guys, he's actually a pretty nice guy. Okay, actually.
As more of my real life friends have been like watching esports, and some of them that I've played games with, like played Dota with in the past, but they never really cared about like watching streams, are starting to kind of like watch streams a little more and be like, oh wow, that's pretty cool. Now I understand what you do. It's weird to hear their feedback on like casters and personalities that they think are good or aren't good when they've just gotten in. Like, they don't have any of that baggage. They don't know any of the drama or who's fucked who or who works for who. They're just like, who's that guy? And one of them was just like, who's that guy on the stage? I'm like, you mean Dakota? He's like, yeah, that guy's awful. I'm like, what? Dakota's like an objectively good stage host. What are you talking about? What, do you live under a rock? And he's just like, I don't think he's funny. I'm like, okay.
That's actually hilarious. Like, that's exactly how I feel about my friends. They just give me these off-the-wall, completely, like... And from my perspective, it's completely wrong. But
yeah,
for them, it just that's just their opinion. Like, who is this guy? They're terrible. Like, wait, what?
Yeah.
I can't believe their taste.
It was funny when my parents, went to ESL New York because it's close to where we live. So they both Seth and my parents attended, at least for some of it. And it was interesting to hear their feedback of what they kind of thought about the panel and people. My dad asked me, not really knowing who he was, he's like, who is the Asian guy at the end of the panel? I was like, Merlini. He's like, that's Merlini. That's the guy you used to live with. I'm like, yeah. He's like, is he sandbagging you or something? It seems like he doesn't really talk that much whenever you ask him a question. I was just like, I mean, I see why you think that, but no, he's just a quiet Asian dude. I don't know. I don't think he's sandbagging me. It was just funny to hear from that perspective. Like, why is that one so quiet? Like, motherfucker, you do need to talk more. God damn it, Merlini.
You know, my mom, as bless her soul, she tried to keep up with some of the Shanghai fun. So she finds whatever she can online. She's not very tech savvy or anything, but I guess she found Shiver's blog, or her vlogs, whatever, rather. And I guess that's how she kept up with the major. So she would just text me, like, she got WhatsApp just for the occasion since I'd be in China. She'd just like message me like once a day, like, I saw Shiver's video today. I saw you in it. You're smiling. It's so great. And like, she's just really generally excited to see me like getting out in the world and like traveling and stuff. But just her opinions on certain things were so funny. She's like, I heard about that guy, James. Don't know what happened there. It seems crazy. It's like, yeah, it's pretty fucking crazy, actually.
Trying to explain the James thing to my parents was difficult because I've told them I'm sort of friends with James, you know, at events. I've definitely spent a few hours chatting with him, and like, sort of look to him as a pseudo mentor figure, not entirely, but you know, he's someone that I see as like knows his shit. And if I ask him stuff, he'll at least like be honest and give me some feedback on if I'm like totally off pace or whatever. So my parents are aware of who he is, kind of, but I played on my podcast number 90 that clip of Purian Flax doing his speech from that interview at like TI4 or TI5. I think it's TI4, where he's saying about how he doesn't like suits and stuff and it should be grassroots. So I played it my podcast. My stepmom was giving me feedback about it, and she was just like, yeah, you know, that clip that you played from James was really good. And I was like, no, that was Purian Flax, another British guy. God, I see why this is confusing, and I did a bad job of explaining it, and I don't know how to differentiate the two now because they don't know who Purian Flax is, the funny guy, you know? And it was just hard to explain, like, the gravity of the CEO of a multi-billion dollar company said the host of this event is, quote, an ass. As one who fancies himself a host and may one day grow into a major role, Jesus Christ, is that scary to witness? Like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Like, I was rattled, man. I was just like, holy shit. Like, I didn't even comprehend that ever happening. Like, the host getting fired from a major and then being, like, publicly defamed by the CEO. It's just, damn. I might not have realized what my goals actually were. Like, geez.
Speaking of which, on the morning of the third day, I think it was, like, very clear. It was after the game post. Everything was kind of up in the air. I had the clarity of mind towards the end of the day to... I was walking out of the room and I saw the easel. The classic easel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
The historic easel at this point. And I thought, you know, what better a souvenir than to grab one of these pages?
Yeah.
And there was only one page left. I guess the others had been thrown away. And so I rolled up one of the pages where he does pros and cons for a few of the teams. Threw that in my backpack, took it back. That's a piece of Dota history. I mean, has there ever been a host that was fired like that in a position like that? I mean, I don't think there will be one for quite a while either. So,
no.
Really.
That's like, I don't want to say once in a lifetime, but that shit does not happen, dude.
Especially
a company
there's a good chance that I have a piece of history there that, like, James essentially might not be doing Dota anymore ever.
I love it, man. That's a smart idea. I wish I had a piece of that thing. You should just cut it up and sell the pieces, you know?
I actually thought of that. I thought, you know, it should have got him to sign these little boxes, each box, and just sell them all. Like, oh, do you want the Alliance Pros piece? You can get it. $399.
God, what a sad day that would be. You know, I was going through my Dota memorabilia the other day, and I'm a little embarrassed and also a little proud that one of the coolest things I have is so obscure. I have a signed t-shirt from, and I actually misspoke the other day. I showed this off on stream, and I had it wrong because I couldn't remember who won which summit. I have the second place team from the Summit 2, I believe. Team DK with Ice, Mushi, Burning, Lanham, and MMY. Does that ring a bell, Robbie?
Wasn't that Summit 1? Summit 1?
It might have been Summit 1. Whichever summit that DK team got second place at, I've got their signatures. So on this cool Twitch shirt here. So I don't know what to do with it now. I feel like nobody knows how cool this is, but it's my most prized Dota possession, I think, outside of my Pipe of Desert.
Really? That is?
Well, what else is there, Robbie? I mean, don't have any other signatures. I don't have any of your toenail clippings to be proud of. Like, what else is there?
I did come down on you a little bit. Like, oh, really? That's all you've got?
I mean, that's pretty badass, dude. That's a unique relic.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I would say that's up there in terms of relics. I have a shirt from, I think, Summit 1 as well. The Cloud9 roster that came there. All their signatures from the team, and it was like the Bone 7 Envy.
I'll give you $50 bucks for it right now.
I mean, man, PayPal me. I'll send it.
my collection of Summit signed T-shirts,
though.
It's
one
what?
One of the super ugly gray Twitch shirts. So.
Oh, that's what mine is.
Oh, wonderful! You'll
it's
have
the exact same
signatures.
Oh, sweet Jesus. All right, Robbie, we got to wrap this thing up, man. Anything else about China, Shanghai,
man,
BTS, esports, Dota?
If you're going to go somewhere and you feel like China is somewhere you might go, I recommend trying it. It's crazy. It's definitely different. It's fun. I loved it personally, and I'm white as all hell.
Dude, like, I really hope I get to do something in Manila. Like, even if it's not talent-related, like what you're talking about, I would love to put out fires at a major. I feel like that sounds like a pretty fun job. I think I could excel in that environment, you know? And I really, like, I mostly want to go to Manila because I just want to see what the Philippines fans are like. Like, I honestly think that event is going to be so fucking crazy for, like, the people that are there live. It's just, I got a taste of it in Malaysia, and I've heard the Philippines are even more buck wild.
Well, I can imagine it's going to be pretty crazy. Like, The dedication of the fans alone is a huge difference, but apparently it sold out and was much cheaper, so I think that the venue is going to be a lot more full.
Oh, yeah.
Generally, like, it is going to be crazy. I would hope to be considered for some help at some point there, but, like, I have no idea. I'm not going to put all my eggs in one basket or anything.
How many gray hairs did you sprout, Rob?
Probably, like, one or two. Nothing close to Merlini, man. That guy's really getting them, but... No, I mean, I thought it was great. I had a hell of a time. It was an amazing experience. You know, the major, for all the production hangups, it did end up actually being broadcast for the most part. So I think that we did okay a job there. I was really happy with it. I think the team building was great. I learned a lot personally about both production and, like, just perspective. It was a good trip. Overall, I'd say it was like a 7.2 out of 10.
To be That's specific. Pretty solid. 7.2. I'll take it.
Badass hat that you may have seen in Dakota's vlogs. If not, you should check that out.
I need to go run it back. I'll check the videotape. My God. Well, thank you so much, Rob, for sharing all of your firsthand information, your account, your tale, heroic tale at that.
Oh, for what it's worth. I had a good time.
That's good. I know we don't talk very often because we're both awful virtual friends, but one of these days, I'm coming to Palm Springs in April visiting family. So
when in April?
The 14th to the 19th.
Okay, we're hanging out. That's right before Smash Summit, man. You got to at least stop by.
When is the actual Smash Summit?
21st starts.
Sweet.
So we'll be doing prep and stuff.
Well, it's like a 4-hour drive to Palm Springs, so I might steal a car or something. Yeah, dude, we got a date. Sweet. We get sushi.
All right.
Or something more Californian.
No, KBBQ. I haven't had sushi in months. Oh. We'll do it.
Oh. All right. We're doing it then. Right, guys, man. If you enjoyed this is Icelement. Follow him on Twitter at Icelement. You know, I was prepping for this the other night. My roommate walked by and was like, Icelement. What an idiot. And I was like, you don't even know him, but
it's a shitty name. It's a shitty name, guys, but I'm here anyways.
All right. Well, guys, thank you so much for joining us for this podcast. This is a weekly occurrence, usually around Mondays, but this week it got a little flubbed up. Zyori Podcast is usually on my Twitch channel, but today it just lined up great to do it right after the C Kappa broadcast and do it here on Moonduck. So if you enjoyed it, follow me at ZyoriTV, and you can find the podcast on iTunes and on a bunch of other podcast feeds. It's just Zyori.tv/podcast if you want to catch some of the old episodes. So until next time, gang, thank you so much, and we'll see you.